Hi everyone, my name is Megan Whitcomb and I'm the media intern for South Bay Church, and we are so excited to have you guys here this Sunday. Church probably looks a little bit different this Sunday than it usually does. If you're at the SDA building, go home. Nobody's coming, nobody's there. We're all meeting in homes, which is very similar to the first century church. And we love doing this. One, it gives our tech team a break and our worship team a break. But two, it's just really fun to get to know each other on a deeper level, to just break bread in the homes, have deeper conversations. It's just a great time for deeper fellowship, and we love doing this from time to time. The lesson that we're going to be showing today is actually 2 years old. Steve Morici recorded it a while back, I think when we were in COVID. And we felt that the lesson is just as prevalent now, if not more, than it was then. It might apply maybe slightly differently, and some of the things that he says might be a little bit different than the things that we're going through now, but the same principles and applications can still be applied. And I'm so excited for us all to hear it again. It's about justice and mishpah and how that has to do with our discipleship and what that means for us. And it's honestly just, it's really great. I'm not going to give too much away. But if you also don't know, the reason that we are meeting in house churches is because a lot of us are also in Orlando right now for the Vision Conference. And if you don't know what that is, feel free to drop a comment in the YouTube section or hit us up on Instagram or Facebook or whatever. We can get you connected to some resources so that maybe you can watch a few of the lessons on stream. And if you do know what it is and you still want to do that, go ahead. We have some links in our bio for Instagram and stuff, but it's going to be a great opportunity for us to just learn some deeper stuff. And if you're there, we're excited to see you guys there. But it's just going to be a great time for us to learn deeper about God's word and fellowship with one another and get to see disciples from all over the world. Even if you're just streaming virtually, it's going to be super cool to see people streaming in from literally everywhere. So it's going to be awesome. And we're so excited that we get to do this, because we only get to do it once every 10 years. So we're super excited for that. So after this little intro that I'm doing, we're going to have a couple of songs, and then Steve is going to do a lesson, and then I'm going to come right back in for us to do a little communion prayer. And so, yeah, that's the plan for today. So excited that you guys are here. Thanks for bearing with us as we figure out how to do this online streaming thing all over again. And yeah, love you guys. Have a fun service.
right? Hallelujah!
What is justice? And, you know, honestly, justice is a subject that we have thousands of years of writing, debate, and philosophical discussions that have taken place across nearly every culture of human history. Some of the greats are Aristotle, Augustine, Plato, and Kant have been engaged in these conversations. And most recently in our culture, the debate has been democratized in that everyone gets a say. Everyone has a vote, everyone has a voice, especially today on the social media page. You know, I remember discussing Kantian ethics in college, which led ultimately to this amazing degree of chaos in the classroom. And basically, the whole concept and theory behind justice when it came to what we were trying to develop in that class was you develop a maxim that leads to a categorical imperative which will enable you to determine if the maxim's good or bad. Now, I think most of us can relate to this one. So say you, as an example, someone develops the maxim, kill anybody that annoys you.
Not a good maxim.
No, not a good maxim, and there's reasons for that. Upon applying it, you can demonstrate that if you held to this universally, it would result in self-termination, which shows us that this maxim is irrational and non-sustainable because it's impossible to hold to. Well, if we did, everybody'd be dead. But this is what I love the most about being a Christian and why I love God's word rather than needing to rely on some flawed or hollow philosophy. We have God's word. Amen? Amen. The question we need to ask ourselves this morning is, are we willing to listen to, and not only listen to God's word, but apply God's word? So what I want to do today is first take a look at a portrait of biblical justice, and this needs to serve as a baseline foundation for the rest of the message this morning, amen? I'd like to focus on a vision of justice found in the Old Testament. Now, for starters, as disciples of Jesus, there are probably as many ways to do justice as we have members in the church. But I would hope we can all agree with that what we're called to by our Creator is to see that justice is done for everyone. Micah, in Micah 6 verse 8, this is where we're going to start out this morning. This is a good starting point. And that, again, we're called to see justice done. Micah lived in a time of international fear and uncertainty, not a whole lot unlike what we're going through today. It was a very turbulent time for him. The kingdom was divided, Israel and Judah. There was this unwillingness to obey God, which led to the division and enslavement to neighboring empires. Micah prophesied from around 742 to 735 BC, and some of his contemporaries were the prophet Amos and Isaiah. And this was during a time when the Assyrian Empire was the dominant power in the region, and there was no real justice based on what God had established for his people. So turn with me to Micah 6:8, or watch along here on the screen. So Micah 6 verse 8 says, "The Lord God has told us what is right and what he demands. See that justice is done. Let mercy be your first concern and humbly obey your God." So what is justice? Well, a good place to start is in the workplace. Justice in work is not just an individual matter. I believe we have a responsibility to make sure that everyone in society has access to the resources needed to provide for one's life, for one's family. And this is honestly one of the things that I've loved most about Hope Worldwide. You know, we have the opportunity to participate with Hope both locally in our communities and worldwide. This goes back a number of years ago. The picture there at the top left is I believe it was in front of the Casillas house before we all went out. I mean, it was awesome. The kids got together. We put together lunches, made sandwiches, had soap, cleaning supplies, shampoo, socks, things of that nature that we bagged and took up to Santa Monica to distribute to the homeless. The other picture there is a senior home consisting of widows and a few widowers in Lebanon that was in total disrepair, covered with junk. We had the opportunity to go in and do some painting, remove the junk. And the thing that was most encouraging was the point of connection we had with the elderly men and women that lived there. We got to sing with them. We got to dance with them. It was so amazing seeing them come out of almost a catatonic state and start smiling and interacting. And then this is a form of justice. And this is what I love about hope. You know, there's a book some of you have read called Hole in the Gospel, which talks about dealing with the poor. And in a lot of ways, looking back at early church, we were so much about getting the gospel out and growth, but there were things we neglected, like the need to find justice and be generous and take care of the poor. And honestly, I was thinking the other night that there's a book I could write called Holes, Plural, in the Gospel. And I think one of the largest ones we're faced with today is in the area of justice. So with that, let's take a look at the prophet Amos and his perspective on his people, the Israelites. We see him criticizing the Israelites for injustice regarding their arrogant disregard for God's law of gleaning. And for those of you that don't know, gleaning was a process by which God had established in the law that those that were unable to be, maybe disabled, whatever the case may be, widowed, to generate an income, if you were a farmer, you were called to leave the edges and the corners so that the poor could come in and glean that for themselves. And there was during this period of time, a lot of the farmers had blown that direction off. And what they were doing now was they were harvesting their field, but then they'd go back to the edges and the corners and they'd make sure that they didn't miss a thing. Those that have olive groves made sure every single olive was stripped off the tree. Those that had vineyards made sure every single grape on the ground or otherwise was collected, so there was nothing for the poor. So according to God's covenant with Israel, farmers were not allowed to glean their own fields. Yet this is what was actually taking place. And I love how thorough God is. I mean, he basically created this form of social welfare based on setting up this opportunity for the poor to work. It wasn't a matter of them just getting a handout. They had to go out and they were able to actually do something that they could feel good about themselves. They were able to, God gave them a means of providing for themselves rather than having to beg or steal or starve. Gleaning was a way for them to participate in dignity of work, even for those that were unable to participate in the labor market due to, again, lack of resources, socioeconomic dislocation, discrimination, disability, or other factors. And I love this about God. God not only wants everyone's needs to be met, but he wants to offer everyone the dignity of working to meet their needs and the needs of others. So Amos reminds the Israelites that this provision was being violated, that farmers are not leaving the stray grain in the field for the poor to glean. And we see this in the book of Amos, chapter 8, verse 4. He says, "You people, you crush those in need and you wipe out the poor. You say to yourselves, how much longer before the end of the new moon festival? When will the Sabbath be over? Our wheat is ready and we want to sell it now. We can't wait to cheat and charge high prices for the grain we sell. We will use dishonest scales and mix dust into the grain. And those who are needy and poor, don't have any money, we'll make them our slaves for the price of a pair of sandals." And this is just how out there we can get if we're not looking to God and God's foundation for what justice really is. This tells us clearly that justice is not only a matter of criminal law and political expression, but also of economic opportunity. The opportunity to work, to meet individuals' needs and family needs. This is essential to the role of the individual within God's covenant, which had been violated by the Israelites. Economic justice is essential. It's an essential component of Micah's famous proclamation in Micah 6:8. The Lord God has told us what is right and what he demands. See that justice is done. Let mercy be your first concern and humbly obey your God. You know, this justice that's being talked about here, justice in the Hebrew, is mishpat. It occurs hundreds of times in the Old Testament, and the most basic meaning is basically to give people their due or to treat people fairly. God demands that his people, as a part of their walk with him, that with that, we demonstrate mercy, we demonstrate kindness, and we do justice individually and socially in every aspect of work and economic life. And for those less fortunate, justice generated inclusion as a part of the family, and inclusion is huge. So justice is about giving others their due and fairness, but what do I mean by fairness? Now, the idea is rooted in humanity's status as image bearers of God, which as disciples we're called to be those image bearers. It's sharing an equal value and dignity. And does that just mean treating all people the same? Well, yes, sometimes. Let me give you an example. The justice system of Israel was to have the same mishpat for foreigners as well as the native Israelite. And that's in Leviticus 24, verse 22. And we see that very same thing when the church was birthed in Acts 2. It talks about how they were devoted to one another, that no one had any needs. Everyone gave to make sure that everybody's needs were taken care of. So this wasn't just an Old Testament law. This is something that carried on through. And we saw it throughout Jesus' ministry. They are to be the same rules and laws. If they're to be just when it comes to judgment, it must be evaluated on merits and evidence, not on race, status, or wealth of the persons involved. And it means keeping your oaths, refusing bribes, not giving preferential treatment to some and not others. And, we saw this again in Acts 6 when the Grecian widows were not having their meats met. Well, when it was brought to the attention of the church, what happened? They made sure there were individuals to represent those women, that justice would be done for them, their needs would be taken care of, their needs would be met. But I think the other thing that we need to realize here is justice in the Bible is not simply treating all people the same. Sometimes, many times in the Old Testament, justice is actually about preferential treatment in the name of fairness. Now, you might be thinking, okay, well, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. How can this be? Isn't that unfair to give some people special treatment to one person or group over another? Well, let's go ahead and continue here. The following is an example, which you should have on the screen right now, is that in the Old Testament, we see this quartet of the vulnerable. And Brian Craig, you're amazing, my brother. Thank you so much for that fan. I don't know if it's the lights in here or what, but anyway, I appreciate him coming to my rescue. I'm not going to break into song, but anyway, I feel like it, though, just so I say it. So with this, though, we have this, in the Old Testament, this quartet of the vulnerable. There are four specific groups of people God wanted to make sure received justice, which includes the widow, the orphan, the immigrant, and the poor. God draws attention to these groups of people. Why? Because they were disproportionately disadvantaged. They were vulnerable, at least more often than most other groups. They had little social power or influence. They lived a life of subsistence, and over the law, wisdom, and the prophets offer this basically and command special protection and treatment for these groups because of their inherent disadvantages. Sometimes we can get caught up in the politics of our land. There's opposition when it comes to illegal aliens that we have here in California. But what does the Bible tell us? How should we treat others? And I think this is the thing we've got to get back to, is that it's not a matter of our political affiliation, what our cultural or ethnic background is. The foundation for all of this is justice. And it's the kind of justice that God wants us to adhere to so people can see us or see God through us. In Deuteronomy 27, verse 19, it reads, "Cursed is anyone who withholds justice from the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow." And the response to that particular passage is, "Then all the people shall say, Amen." Amen? Proverbs 31, verse 8 says, "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy." Zechariah 7:10 reads, "Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the foreigner or the poor. Do not plot evil against each other." I've been studying out justice for probably the last 4 weeks now, and I'm blown away by how much of the Bible resonates for what we're currently going through today, but just this absolute disregard for what God calls us to. As Christians, as a Christian nation, however you want to view it, we're not adhering to what God has established. And justice with an emphasis on the vulnerable is doing justice in a way to give the world an accurate reflection of God in whom justice is ultimately derived. Justice with a special concern for the vulnerable is based in the nature of God himself. I mean, think about this for a minute, guys. Weren't all of us vulnerable before we became Christians? Weren't all of us vulnerable before we became Christians? We were all poor spiritually. We were subject to the accusations of Satan regarding our sin. And here are a few of the eye-opening descriptions of this reality. In Deuteronomy 10, verse 17, it says, "For the Lord your God is God of gods, Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and he loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt." You know, you think about the Jews in Egypt. They were the foreigners. They were the subjugated. They had no rights. They had no justice. They were enslaved by that country and that empire. And yet, they had forgotten what they themselves had gone through and weren't granting what God had granted them by delivering them out of Egypt. You know, these are challenging but loving scriptures. I love God's heart in all of them, especially regarding what Paul says in the New Testament. Paul tells about the Jew and Gentile being reconciled to God through Christ. In Ephesians 2, verse 11, it reads, "Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world." And we know that's no longer the case for any of us that make Jesus Christ Lord of our lives, and that Christ was the price that was paid for our sin. Justice for us as sinners would have been eternal damnation. But God provided a means of our sin being taken care of so we'd have the opportunity to no longer be foreigners, that we'd be his children because of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ was willing to pay for us. Through that justice, there is true inclusion for all that make Jesus Lord and are baptized into the name of Christ. In Psalm 146, verse 7, it reads, "He upholds the cause of the oppressed, and he gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigners, and he sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the ways of the wicked." You know, looking at this passage, who would the righteous be in this passage? You know, when any individual or group is neglected, it's not called merely a lack of mercy or charity, but a violation of justice, a violation of mishpah. God loves and defends those with the least economic and social power. Therefore, so should we. That's mishpah. That's justice done. So with these passages in mind, it's clear to me that justice is about restoring. It's about restoration. Justice is corrective. Justice, especially on a societal level, is about punishment for the guilty and protections for the innocent. Justice is about retribution for wrongdoers and reparations for victims. And this twofold picture of restoration ultimately is central to justice. Justice brings down those who step on others to get ahead, and it lifts those up who are stepped on. You know, for me, the most significant part of this, and this is what I love about God, the most significant part of this is relational. Justice is about relationships. It's about our relationship with God. It's about our relationship with one another. Doing justice means moving towards relational transformation and flourishing together, getting deep with one another. And you know, this is what our faith families within the church are about. This is the significance of our FOO, our family of origin, to know and be known. This is huge. To implement justice in the community needs to start right here in the church. Justice is to acknowledge a problem, namely that someone's out of alignment with another. You know, why do we see this talk about being resolved? Matthew 18, there's so many passages. If there's an issue with your brother, what are we supposed to do? We got to get it resolved. We got to work through it. We've got to communicate to one another. We need to figure out what is the thing that has us stalled relationally. What is it that's keeping us from flourishing in our individual relationships? Righteousness in the Bible is not merely primarily about private morality or spirituality. Let's take a look at the next slide here. See, in the Old Testament, The relational side of justice is especially clear with mishpat, justice done, but it's connected with tzedakah, which means righteousness. So righteousness in the Bible is not primarily about private morality or private spirituality, but about relational morality, about spirituality. First and foremost, it's got to start with us personally and our relationship with God. If it's not there, it's not going to cross over into the rest of it. So from there, what does that mean today? What does that look like for our lives today? It's got to be first and foremost with God relationally and then with one another. Righteousness is about conducting all relationships with fairness and generosity. Again, righteousness is about conducting all relationships with fairness and generosity. You know, generosity for some might be nothing more than you being willing to set aside the time to have a conversation, demonstrating empathy. In light of everything that's going on today, how you doing, bro? How you doing, sister? I know how it makes me feel, but I want to get to know you. Let's talk about this together. Let's connect. Let's allow for this relational aspect of our lives to flourish. Then we'll have the ability to really make a difference within our communities. Righteousness, to put it simply, is to be in a right relationship with God and people. It's what the world would look like today if everyone embraced Matthew 22, starting in verse 37. If you want to turn there with me, Matthew 22, verse 37. And this is an amazing passage. It's something that Jesus carries over from what righteousness and justice look like with the law, but it demonstrates for us personally with his concern and his generosity and the love that he outpoured for each and every one of us. In Matthew 22, verse 37, it reads, Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." This is where it starts, with this relationship with God, but then it moves on from there. "This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." You know, we see Paul citing that later in one of his epistles. And it, you know, you've heard me share this before, church. I love this in that there were 630-something individual laws that were established in the Old Testament. And Jesus comes along and says, "You know what, guys? Here's the two. Here's the greatest, and here's the second, and this is all you got to worry about. You take care of these two, and everything else will fall into place." I'm telling you, after going through this Appendix F and what it looks like for a church to get together again, and there's I don't know, there's maybe 50 or 100 different boxes to check there. Imagine checking 637 of those darn boxes every day to make sure you're right with God. I'll pass, but I'll take these two, and I'll embrace the heck out of them and really strive to live this way, amen? It's what the world would look like. Just imagine this for a moment. If everybody adhered to this passage and loved God and their neighbor, what would this world look like today? You know, obviously with what we see going on today, it's not the case. The world is full of unrighteous people, and it's so full of injustice. Justice and righteousness then are the work of bringing realignment, reintegration, and relational restoration to people. Job is a great biblical example of this social justice in action. You know, who is Job? Most of us Christians know he's a guy that really had a pretty decent life up until one point and where it became totally jacked up. I mean, even his own wife at one point was telling him, "Dude, just curse God and die." But we have this biblical example of social justice in his life. And that Job was this wealthy man living in a land called Uz with a large family and extensive flocks. It was amazing what ended up transpiring in his life. Before God, he was viewed as blameless and upright, always careful to avoid doing evil, Job 1, verse 1. And then we see Satan approaching God about Job. You know, because God boasted Job about what an amazing person Job is, his goodness, his righteousness. And then Satan gets into this argument that Job's only good because, you know, he's blessed with wealth, he's got it really easy, he's got everything he wants. So Satan challenges God that if given permission to punish Job, that Job would ultimately turn and curse God. So God allows Satan to torment Job to test his claim, but he forbids Satan from taking Job's life. But in the process, Job loses everything. His house collapses on his children. Warring tribes come in and steal all of his camels, oxen, and donkeys. All his sheep are destroyed. All of his servants are killed, with the exception of the ones that brought him the messages about everything that had transpired that was going on so crazy, out of control. And in response to losing everything, Job responds in chapter 1, verse 20. After hearing all this horrendous news, Job got up, tore his robe, shaved his head, then fell to the ground in worship, and he said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with any wrongdoing. With that, let's go ahead and fast forward to Job 29. I'm using the contemporary English version on this particular translation, and I just love the nuances here. Here's Job recounting how he lived his life. "When poor people or orphans cried out for help, I came to the rescue, and I was highly praised for my generosity to widows and others in poverty. Kindness and justice were my coat and hat. I was good to the blind and to the lame. I was a father to the needy, and I defended them in court, even if they were strangers. When criminals attacked, I broke their teeth, and I set their victims free." Justice is generous. Justice is generous. Did you notice the nature of justice in action according to Job here? In our areas of service today, Job's at the homeless shelter serving meals. He's at the Department of Children and Family Services visiting the orphans and or foster children. He's in the courts fighting to right the wrongs of injustice in society. He's at the funeral home, the nursing home, the hospital, the volunteer police force. I think for us, just remembering that justice isn't just about keeping laws, and it's not even just about treating people fairly. To Job, justice is much more to do with treating people generously. These are the acts of mercy and kindness. They're love and charity. And in the biblical framework of things, what we see demonstrated in his mercy, his kindness, his love, and his charity is the biblical framework that basically defines justice. I think for us as a church, we need to understand if we fail to act in mercy, charity, and generosity, this is not just a failure to do some optional thing. It's a failure to do justice as well as a failure to honor and glorify God. And if you need more on that, you'll have the time. I don't right now, but take a look at Job 31, verses 13 through 28. You know, Job wanted others to prosper and to do well. So we see him working for that form of transformation and restoration. Job notices those whose path to flourishing has stalled, and he wants to get in there and make a difference. He did something about it. He uses his preferred position, not for self-advancement, but for advancement of those that were vulnerable. And this is the biblical justice and righteousness that God calls us to. It's also the biblical acts of charity and mercy that we're called to. See, I believe if Job were here today, we would see him radically, generously giving of his time and resources to activism that seeks to end particular forms of injustice, violence, and oppression. I love Job's character and conduct. He didn't become bitter, angry, or entitled. He did demonstrate, though, this incredible degree of love, mercy, kindness, and justice that has been unequaled until the coming of Christ. And after all of this, you might be wondering, what would I like to see for each of you as your evangelist? What do you think I would like to see in the characteristics of our church, the members of our church? I would like to see us continue to transform ourselves by spending more time reading God's word than watching the news or spending time on social media. You know, if you're going to be on social media, what I'd love to see you doing is rather than arguing your political stance, how about we get on social media and we argue the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, with those that have yet to embrace it, those that have yet to hear it, because of our silence in the area that we need to be vocal in. You know, I hear a lot about this COVID thing and we're locked in our homes and violation of civil rights and, you know, it's violating our role as Christians. Last time I checked, guys, There's no problem with this, the degree of interaction elsewhere in the world today when it comes to all the things that are wrong with it, all the things politically that need to change. But I'd love to see 10% of what we've got going on with all the negativity being spent on the positivity that we have through the good news, through Jesus Christ. Rather than expressing our political views on social media, how about using it as a platform to be known, to know and be known for who we are? Not as whether or not you swing left or right politically, but how you were transformed and restored to the narrow path, and how Jesus Christ redirected your individual lives and has enabled you to redirect those lives that have yet to know the good news. So by refocusing on what's important and meaningful to God, we can become this agent of change that everybody's talking about, but very few are acting out. God's agent of change and a light in this unjust world is what God wants us to be. So finally, for those of you that are more visually inclined, I have a short video from the Bible Project on the biblical framework of justice. And then we'll come on back and we'll have a prayer for the communion.
If you were a praying mantis, it would be socially acceptable to devour your mate.
And if you're a honey badger, you have no regard for other animals. You don't care.
If you're a panda with twins, it's normal to abandon one to take care of the other.
But if humans do any of these things, we would call it wrong, unfair, or unjust.
Yeah, why is that? Why do humans care so much about justice?
Well, the Bible has a fascinating response to that question. On page one, humans are set apart from all other creatures as the image of God.
Yeah, God's representatives who rule the world by his definition of good and evil.
And this identity, it's the bedrock of the Bible's view of justice. All humans are equal before God and have the right to be treated with dignity and fairness no matter who you are.
And that would be nice if we all did that. But we know how the world really works.
And the Bible addresses that too. It shows how we are constantly redefining good and evil to our own advantage at the expense of others.
Yeah, self-preservation. And the weaker someone is, the easier it is to take advantage of them.
And so in the biblical story, we see this happening on a personal level, but also in families, and then in communities, and in whole civilizations that create injustice, especially towards the vulnerable. But the story doesn't end there. Out of this whole mess, God chose a man named Abraham to start a new kind of family. Specifically, Abraham was to teach his family to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice.
Yeah, doing righteousness, that's a Bible word I don't really use. But what comes to mind is being a good person.
But what does that even mean, being good? The biblical Hebrew word for righteousness is tzedakah, and it's more specific. It's an ethical standard that refers to right relationships between people. It's about treating others as the image of God.
With the God-given dignity they deserve.
And this word justice, it's the Hebrew word mishpat. It can refer to retributive justice.
Like if I steal something, I pay the consequences.
Exactly. Yet most often in the Bible, mishpat refers to restorative justice. It means going a step further, actually seeking out vulnerable people who are being taken advantage of and helping them.
Yeah, some people call this charity.
But mishpat involves way more. It means taking steps to advocate for the vulnerable and changing social structures to prevent injustice.
So justice and righteousness are about a radical, selfless way of life.
Yeah, and you find this idea all over the Bible. Like, here, in the book of Proverbs, what does it mean to bring about just righteousness?
Open your mouth for those who can't speak for themselves.
And what do these words mean for the prophets, like Jeremiah?
Rescue the disadvantaged, and don't tolerate oppression or violence against the immigrant, the orphan, and the widow.
And like here, look in the book of Psalms.
The Lord God upholds justice for the oppressed, gives food to the hungry, and sets the prisoner free. But he thwarts the way of the wicked. Whoa, he thwarts the wicked?
Yeah, in Hebrew, the word wicked is rasha. It means guilty or in the wrong. It refers to someone who mistreats another human, ignoring their dignity as an image of God.
So justice and righteousness is a big deal to God.
Yes, it's what Abraham's family, the Israelites, were to be all about. They ended up as immigrant slaves being oppressed unjustly in Egypt. And so God confronted Egypt's evil, declaring them to be rasha, guilty of injustice. and so he rescued Israel. But the tragic irony of the Old Testament story is that these redeemed people went on to commit the same acts of injustice against the vulnerable. And so God sent prophets who declared Israel guilty.
But they weren't the only ones. There's injustice everywhere.
Yeah, some people actively perpetrate injustice. Others receive benefits or privileges from unjust social structures they take for granted. And sadly, history has shown that when the oppressed gain power, they often become oppressors themselves.
So we all participate in injustice, actively or passively, even unintentionally. We're all the guilty ones.
And so this is the surprising message of the biblical story. God's response to humanity's legacy of injustice is to give us a gift, the life of Jesus. He did righteousness and justice, and yet he died on behalf of the guilty. But then God declared Jesus to be the righteous one when he rose from the dead. And so now Jesus offers his life to the guilty so that they too can be declared righteous before God, not because of anything they've done, but because of what Jesus did for them.
The earliest followers of Jesus experienced this righteousness from God, not just as a new status, but as a power that changed their lives and compelled them to act in surprising new ways.
Yeah, if God declared someone righteous when they didn't deserve it, the only reasonable response is to go and seek righteousness and justice for others.
This is a radical way of life, and it's not always convenient or easy. It's courageously making other people's problems my problems.
This is what Jesus meant by loving your neighbor as yourself. It's about a lifetime commitment fueled by the words of the ancient prophet Micah. God has told you, humans, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you is to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Wow, that was literally chef's kiss. Thank you so much, Steve. That was amazing. I really am so grateful just for the reminder about what it means to be in right relationship with God. I think I can often make it about so many things that maybe it's not supposed to be about. But really, I'm so grateful for this reminder of like, this is a really big part of it too. And what it means to be in right relationship with God, right relationship with each other, and with the earth. So I'm really grateful for that and how great of an example even Jesus is of what it means to look out for the marginalized, look out for the other, you know, the people in society that society has really outcasted, the people who are on the outskirts. And I'm sure we've all really felt like we were those people before too. And we know what it feels like when somebody brings us in, when somebody includes us, when somebody helps make our really terrible situation and makes it better, and how grateful we are for that. And so I'm really grateful that God includes us in that mission, and that he entrusts us to do so. So thanks, Steve. It's literally an amazing lesson. I'm so grateful for that. So I'm going to go ahead and pray. And then there's going to be a song right after that. So go ahead and bow your heads or whatever you do in your homes. But hi, Dad. Thank you so much just for this lesson. Thank you so much for this time that we just get to meet in each other's homes. I just love the intimacy and the closeness that comes with just coming to each other's houses and eating and drinking coffee and having belly laughs and sitting on each other's couches and meeting each other's pets. I love, love, love home churches and house churches. I think there's just nothing like it. I'm so grateful for the friendships and the fellowships that come with just being with one another. And I just love fellowship in that way. God, I'm just so grateful for Jesus and the life that he lived. Thank you so much for his dedication to the marginalized, his dedication to the other, his dedication to bringing the people on the outskirts and centering his entire life around meeting their needs and seeing them and seeing beyond their conditions. I know it's so easy for me personally to label people whatever they're struggling with. Oh, they're this. Oh, they're that. And just seeing their whatever it is as their entire identity. And God, I'm so grateful that Jesus calls us son. He calls us daughter. He calls us something that has nothing to do with the things that we're struggling with. And he just shows us belonging. And God, I'm so grateful for, I'm so grateful for the death that he died. I can't imagine how, I don't even know if that made sense, the death he died, but you know, the death he underwent. But I know how, I can't even imagine how incredibly difficult that was, but I'm also so incredibly grateful for the life that he lived, and how incredibly difficult that must have been as well. And just, I'm grateful for both equally, honestly, the death that, you know, gave us the salvation for our sins and, or not the salvation, but the forgiveness of our sins and the chance to have salvation for our sins. But God, I'm just so grateful for all of that. And just the example that he gives us to now live our lives, just like him, to walk like him, to, give people, I don't know, just encourage people in the same ways that he did, and to give people hope, and to, I don't know, to heal and restore and just participate in the same work that he did. I'm just so incredibly grateful. So anyways, God, I'm so grateful for that. And God, I just want to pray for our community, as they hurt and they grieve. And, God, I just want to pray a special prayer for the victims of the families of the victims of, Peck Park. God, I can't even imagine how they're feeling. I know that hits super close to home for all of us. I'm sure tons of us have been there, have gone there multiple times, grew up going there, and it's just, it hits so close to home, God. And so I just pray, you know, for comfort, for, healing, God, that they can just feel your presence. They can feel close to you, God. And I also just pray for the various ailments and, illnesses that our family here and beyond that they're going through, God. I know sickness is something that's just incredibly difficult and, intimate, God, you know, as, and people struggle with that, you know, so often, God. And so I just pray for that, pray for that they feel comfort, that they feel peace, that they can feel, relief, whether it be mentally or physically, God. So God, I just pray for all of those things. And I'm just so grateful for Jesus and the ways that he really does care about us during those incredibly difficult times. So I love you so much. Thank you so much for this time of communion, for this time of fellowship. I'm just so grateful for the refreshment that it provides to our souls. So I love you tons. And I pray this honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. We're going to have a song, and I hope and pray that you guys just have an amazing rest of your day. Yeah. No. Bye.